Molly play piano. Nano man, that was a 24/7 special on the cable channel. So Ray J went straight to the radio station the very next day. Hey Fab, I'ma kill you. Lyrics coming at you with supersonic speed.
JJ Fab.
Summer, I'ma do my lama. You assuming I'm a human? What I gotta do to get it through to you? I'm superhuman, innovative, and I made a rubber so that anything you say is ricocheting off of me and it'll glue to you and devastating. More than ever, demonstrating how to give a motherfucking audience a feeling like it's levitating, never fading. And I know the haters are forever waiting for the day that they can say I fell off. They'll be celebrating because I know the way to get them motivated. I make elevating music. You make elevator music. Oh, he's too mainstream. Well, that's what they do when they get jealous. They confuse it. It's not hip hop, it's pop. Cause I found a colorway to use it. With rock, shock rap, with die. Go on, lose yourself, and make them lose it.
I don't know how to make songs like that. I don't know what words to use.
Let me know when it occurs to you while I'm ripping any one of these verses. The verses you.
Elevator music. Welcome to the Wellbeing Podcast. Kicking it off with a little Eminem, just getting kind of. Ready for...
I sound like a Jersey accent there. Podcast.
I'm your host, Scott Frost, along here with my co-host...
Sumer Basin.
I think it's been a couple weeks, and that's... it's partially my fault, I guess. we were going to do...
It's your bowels' fault.
Yeah, it's my bowels' fault. Well, which is my fault, because I didn't put enough fiber in my body, but... yeah, we were going to do a Q&A, I think, a few weeks ago, and we'll still line that up and make sure we do that, because it's just a way to kind of touch base with the things that, you know, everyone is really struggling with and really thinking about. But I guess we'll talk a little bit more about that, but talk to me about, you know, the progress that you're seeing with the gym, and also with that one guy, Nicholas, who was having spondy issues, and we talked about bracing, and so...
Yeah, so I guess in the past, it's been 2 weeks, right, since I saw you?
Sure.
I guess it's been 2 weeks. 2 weeks. It's getting more and more busy here at the gym. Every week, we seem to be adding more people, which is great, but I think I'm ready to accept help. I keep saying that. But I think now my new idea is to create like a Train Life Fit Academy for coaches. So it's not quite a certification per se. It's more just like an academy. It's like people come and they get to learn a lot about how to assess an individual, how to actually coach them rather than knocking them down in the dirt and giving them a quote-unquote workout in the sweat. So that's one of the ideas that was pitched to me. A lot of coaches right now in the field want me to start it. And I was kind of almost envisioning it as almost like a space where – even have like guest speakers. Like I would love to have you come in and just like take over a whole like
drop bombs
about like the spiral from the you know from the top to the bottom, even the fascial lines, all these different things, and just really really give a cool like environment for people to grow, not just you know the everyday person but a coach that wants to coach somebody. I think that's really powerful, because then when you can create leaders, then those are the kind of people I want to work with anyway. So instead of like just hiring someone off the bat, I thought maybe if I can take them to this program and see them evolve and gain their own insights from like a good like blueprint, I can trust them more rather than just being like.
Have you? That's cool. Have you also maybe thought about how some of the people that you are possibly working with, they could also enter just the academy program if they want to kind of learn a little bit deeper about themselves? And because I think we mentioned a couple podcasts ago about how I really feel that if you're not coaching, you're not really investigating your own wellness.
Yeah.
And so I think there's so much value. I mean, think how many like how many seminars we go to, and just the continuous learning, and you know the sort of I guess I was listening to Tony Robbins speak. And he was talking about how the I guess he's got a new book coming out on finances, and where he interviews where he interviews basically the top 12 income earners like in the world, and he said that the two common pieces is that they know that they're going to be wrong, like where instead of they just hope that they think that it's going to go well, they're like they know they're going to be wrong, so that they're accounting for that. But then also the other thing was that they're obviously lifelong learners. And I think that, you know, that's something that
it's a good idea.
Being a lifelong learner as a coach is a must. But I also feel that that can translate down to the client and that to the individual, and that I would really encourage people who are trying to become well to look at it from maybe a coach's perspective, maybe doing an academy, enrolling in it, and just to further your own and cultivate your own learning for it. And honestly, the majority of stuff that I've done has been at that purpose, and then it just so happened that I'm in the profession and I use it. But I would have pursued that anyway, and I think sometimes people don't pursue it because they think it's more like a coaching perspective. You know, so I think there could be great benefit for also your clients.
Mm.
It empowers them to then go out in the world and, you know, give coaching to their family and to their friends. And, like, you know, I think that's multiplication.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with that. And actually, it's a funny thing you mentioned that in classes, I've begun to create this culture where I'm having my clients assess and coach other people. So if someone's doing a back squat and they just got done with their squat, for example, I'm like, all right, I want you to watch Jessica now and tell me what you find. And they'll start looking for things like pulling down through your hams, bracing properly, pushing up to the bar, all these small things. And they'll start finding it, and then it reflects back on themselves. And so when they actually go and do their set, they're even more mindful of what they're doing. So that's a really good point.
That's basically like the I think like the culture of like a West Side Barbell powerlifting culture, or that in terms of the coaching each other, obviously not in terms of the breaking weights and setting, you know, world records type thing. But you know, but you have to think about it as like you're setting your own world records.
Yeah.
I mean, you're setting your own health records and health standards. So, but essentially that AJ Roberts, who was a lifter there, who held the all-time world record, actually, in the squat, bench, and deadlift for a little bit of time, was talking about that when you leave West Side Barbell as a gym, you're not just leaving the gym. He's like, you're not just leaving Louis Simmons, who's, you know, the head of the entire, like, family. He's like, you're leaving West Side Barbell because, you know, you're leaving the team, and the team expects you to, you know, to change weights, to load plates, to, you know, to take your rounds. But then also because the coaching of each other is so vital to their culture that everybody is watching you lift every time, and then you're watching them lift, and everybody is coaching, because one of the things he talked about was that Louis really wants to lift. Like, that's his passion. Is he coaches because he's unable to lift the way he used to.
Yeah.
But he really loves to lift. And I think what he does really well is he builds cultures of people, like, everybody coaching everybody. And, like, you start to become really dependent on that. But I also think, I mean, how powerful is that as a concept, that he's not only breeding, I mean, every single one of those people that leaves that gym, like, think about the big names like Jim Wendler and like AJ Roberts and Andy Bolton. I don't think Andy Bolton was there. No. Mm-hmm. But even like Dave Tate and I mean, the list just goes on and on and on. Mark Bell, like, they all kind of become really good coaches because they were coaching the whole time there. And I think that's a really powerful thing to bring to membership, you know, in that way.
That's true. And I've actually had two people actually interested in that program that were members. So go figure. I think that's really important to breed that culture, because, you know, just like the cliche statement, if you can teach something, then you really start to embody it.
I'd even love to be a part of that.
I think it'd be cool. I think it'd be fun to create that kind of environment. But yeah, that's on the horizon, and I'm looking to get that going pretty quick. I'm also looking to co-host a retreat in San Diego, and thinking about making it as part of the entire package, like an entire TLF Academy. So it's like a tier system. If you choose to do the 3-month program, you invest X amount. If you choose to do the 3-month program plus the retreats, which could be like a host of guest speakers, like, say, for example, I call you on to do a guest speaking spot in San Diego. I call like my other friend who does physical therapy here at Next Level Therapy in Austin. I can have like a whole team of people like talking from different angles. Mm-hmm. A nutrition person that's really like specialist or specialized in that. They get so much more value for maybe a higher tier. So I'm thinking about logistics right now and how to do it. I think it would be a good natural step because we're expanding quick and I need help fast. And I think I even had a realtor talk to me. The realtor that got me here to the current gym, he was like, hey, how's it going? And I told him what's going on. It's like, you may want to consider looking at another spot, like a bigger space.
Yeah, yeah.
earlier than later, because Mueller right now, the place that I'm at, is blowing up, and it's actually in construction. And by the time it's like 2016, 2017, it's going to be like a
different. Yeah.
And place, all commercial spots will be taken, I'm sure. So if I get on it now, I can start looking for like my dream spot, my dream like 3,000 square foot like playground, where I can just like really, you know, soup it up and put all the things that are essential, but all the things that my clients want too. So I've started a list. Clients like, oh, we want monkey bars, we want ropes, you know, that we can climb, we want X, Y, and Z maces and clubs and
yeah.
You know, all that fun stuff. So I kind of want to make it this fun environment where it's your gym.
Right.
You know, it's like, it's our gym.
Right, and then it's a culture of coaching each other.
Yep.
Yeah.
And, you know, sometimes I have 8 people classes, and it's a lot of people. Yeah. So I have to create that coaching culture, otherwise it's just a freaking shit show.
Right.
So anyway, that's where I'm at. And
how's the bracing going?
The bracing has been pretty. So if you guys listened to I think 2 episodes ago, probably.
No, I think maybe the last one.
Butthole breathing. Really, really good episode. And I think that has really transformed the way I look at things. Just everyday life. If I'm sitting on a chair and I just start breathing that way, I don't have to really think about posture that much. Like the whole Kelly's Tourette, pull your shoulders back, bring your pelvis into neutral spine. That's very external, and that's a little harder to do and harder to be mindful of. But if I just focus on breath, it auto-corrects a lot of those things. So that's been...
You can also like over... You can also tend to like over-retract. Like,
yeah.
And then you like kind of create a very external, hard bracing. And it's very... It's actually very fatiguing because you're bracing very hard. And also, I think that when you tend to retract a lot, you tend to kind of... override into the problem that you usually always have, which is probably an overbuilt upper trap and an underbuilt lower trap.
Yeah, you know? That's true. That's really true. Yeah, no. I think it's been tremendous for that in itself. But even just every lift just seems easier. Like every lift's gone up like 20 pounds at least, because it just seems like it flies up.
Yeah, whatever. I just changed your life with bundles.
Yeah, pretty much. And it's a very simple cue. You know, I think it could be hard sometimes to relay proper bracing to someone else, even to feel it in that particular way. I think the whole butthole thing makes a lot of sense for people. Even though it's crude, it's just like I draw a diagram on the board. I'm like, here's your butthole. Take it up to your stomach, your belly button. They're like, oh, so I'm supposed to feel tension around my midline. I'm like, yeah, you'll feel tension. And it's like, it feels like a deep tension. I'm like, yeah, it's supposed to feel like a deep tension. Like, oh, this is what I'm supposed to feel. Like, okay, now breathe into that. They're like, oh, that's what I'm supposed to breathe into. And then it makes a lot more sense because they don't know where to put their breath. It's like, inhale, where do I inhale?
Yeah.
You know, so.
And I think that you sort of layer it, right? I mean,
you start
at the deepest point, and you start at the most, you know, distal or downstream or like the furthest away from the diaphragm, right? And then you're kind of like coming up. And I'm doing a lot of work right now with a PT, Michelle Harris, who's the wife of Dr. David Harris, who's doing my prolo. And one of the things that I kind of picked up from her was a good third cue, which I think is like, you know, I've always used, you know, pull the butthole up into the belly button, pull the belly button into that place. But then I kind of like this idea of folding your hip bones together, because it gives this circumferential, like this around perspective that you're not just up and in, but you're up in and then around. Around.
Like, I feel the obliques that way too, actually. I feel the obliques.
Right, but you'll feel the obliques from like the under layer, because you'll feel transverse first and then it'll resonate outward, right. Which is kind of something I've been talking about this actually for, I don't know, a good 5+ years, is this idea of generating, your strength and your force from an inside out perspective, instead of like kind of forcing everything from the outside. Because if you really can't, you can't go from outside in. Cause if you lock down outside, the inside goes soft and it really won't, it's not going to kick back up.
Yeah.
So trying to go outside in is, it still keeps you awkwardly loose on the inside and doesn't really brace your skeleton. So I'd always sort of talked about like creating, and Dr. Conway had always talked about being explosive, like a